This is the community psychology and occupied movement workshop. It was listed as a paper, but just wanted to clarify this will be a very interactive time. So we're not going to be doing a lot of talking. I am notorious for spilling things, so please keep all liquids away from me. There's a good chance it'll get dumped. If so, I'm going to go ahead and have my colleagues introduce themselves so you get an idea, just a small idea of who we are and what we're about.
My name is Mary. I'm a graduate student at Penn State in the Community Psychology Program, and I'm really active with Occupy Harrisburg.
My name is Rosetta Rodriguez. I'm also a graduate student at Penn State in Harrisburg in the Community Psychology Program.
I'm Holly
Angelique.
I'm a faculty member at Penn State Harrisburg, and I'm the one who organized this with all the students beside why is it community psychology saying or doing anything
wrong? I said, well, we are community psychology.
My name is Boris Hines. I'm also a grad student at Penn State Harrisburg in psychology and social change. Heavily involved in the Occupy movement. Glad to see everyone here.
I'm Khalid Al-Fadli. I'm a master. I'm doing a master in community psych and social change. I'm from Saudi Arabia.
You're all saying that you're really active in the Harrisburg area, which is true, but you also spend a lot of time on Wall Street as well.
That's why I said the Occupy movement.
A lot of us have been to New York. Some of us have been to Occupy DC or Occupy Congress. Different involvement levels with different folks. So.
I don't really know what everybody's background is or how familiar you guys are with the Occupy movement. So I just have a little bit of background history to give you. Originally in July, Adbusters had put out this advertisement in their magazine. And it was simply this one-page ad, and it said Wall Street. You know, October 17th, come and bring snacks. And then at the very bottom, it said, what is our one demand? And that was it. So the USA of Rage, I don't know if you guys are familiar with that, it's another organization that has been demanding to take corporate money out of Congress for a long time. They kind of probably need this advertisement, and they spread the word even further. So nobody really knew what was going to happen on the 17th, but lots of people came, and they brought their tents. So after that, like, the movement just kind of spread throughout the country, which I think is really exciting. I also think it's really exciting that everybody here today is here. Okay, so Occupy Wall Street developed this declaration, which we have copies of. And the declaration is, in a sense, it's a list of grievances that the movement has with our government. Some of these grievances talk about corporate personhood and getting rid of corporate personhood. Of course, another one is about removing corporate donations from elections. There's also stuff about stopping illegal foreclosures and enacting a living wage, because most people can't really live on living wage. But there's also lots and lots of other things that these grievances encompass. Occupy Wall Street is primarily organized through different working groups. As far as the working groups go, if you're interested in a certain subject area, you can create that working group, and you get other people that are interested in the same thing to become part of it, and they're usually focused around a specific topic or a specific grievance. Decisions for the Occupy movement are generally made at General Assemblies. General Assemblies usually happen a few times a week, and they use the consensus process. The consensus process is, it's kind of designed to give everybody a voice and to allow everybody to have a chance to be heard. It doesn't work like a democracy that we have in place, not by votes. So as far as that process goes, what happens is a working group will have an idea, and they will work that idea into a proposal, and they'll take it to the General Assembly, and they will have it heard, and then participants are able to give feedback on that, to ask questions and things like that, and any concerns that people have are addressed and worked out. So if all the questions and concerns are addressed and worked through, then that proposal will become, okay, so if everything's worked out, then that proposal will move on to become something that the movement endorses and moves forward with. If all the questions and concerns cannot be answered, then it goes back to the working group to be revised.
So the movement itself also tries to be non-hierarchical and realist in nature, meaning that anyone can make something happen. Which kind of brings us to why we're here today.
Our purpose here today, we would like to be, once we have signed all along the wall, what these are groups based upon the Monterey Declaration, which states what community psychology purposes are, as everyone has a copy. And if you keep those with me, we're going to have a couple of
questions. Yeah.
And so what we would like is to take the Monterey Declaration and combine the Declaration of the Occupy movement and come up with some plans, some tangible plans, that we can present for psychology support of the Occupy movement. That's part of the reason that we're streaming live. There doesn't, Occupy doesn't think that there's a lot of academic support. So we want to voice our support as a community psychology for the Occupy movement, because it is actual research and it is our lives. So when we break up, we'd like everyone to kind of find a group that you think that you can fit with, and we're going to have people working along with you, just facilitating to keep the process moving. We understand that we're not going to get it all completed today, so later on we're going to continue to work on it. We're going to ask if you would like to leave your email address, if you'd like to stay involved. We have a Pittsburgh Declaration group on Facebook, and we're going to present it both to community psychology and to the Occupy group. That's our goal.
So let me say, when you get into the group, you have three goals, and right here doesn't go more specifically. But one of the things we notice is that other groups, like psychologists or social responsibility, can come out with letters or something, declarations in support of the Occupy movement, community psychics and all. So our first goal is that we want to come up with a rationale in support of what this is going to be about. Given the tenets of the deal, right? We're going to come up with a rationale that we can then send a letter to the executive committee saying, please, you know, we've drafted a letter of support. Please endorse this. So that's number one. Then we're going to write our own declaration in some ways following this idea of the Monterey Declaration, which I'll talk about in one second. Our own declaration, because we are community psychology, right? So it doesn't matter what the executive committee does or doesn't. We can write a declaration right here, right now, that says we here in this room support it. And then we'd also like to that would be a declaration that we would write that get published in the Peer Psychologist, for example. Then we also want to write a letter that we can send to the Occupy folks. So we have three goals that we're going to try to get at. Why this Monterey Declaration, you might ask? Well, partly because I wrote it. Do I need more? It's one of maybe only two recent documents that really outlines how one group of people who went to the Monterey Declaration one group of people got together and said, this is how we think community psychology should address oppression. And we came up with this declaration. So it outlined some of those ways. We see overlap between what community psychologists, including me, did then and what Occupy Wall Street's declaration is doing now. So using the sort of overlap. Sorry, and I'll stop now. So if everybody can find, pick their favorite topic. There's community university collaboration, consciousness raising, ethical obligation, global perspective, utopian vision, and human behavior. So pick up a chair and move.
I think I'm actually going to sit here. So for ease and also because it makes sense.
I'm going to get We really need to move. Okay, bring chairs with you. So think about little round tables.
Yes.
We're gonna get a sort of our wiring here. I did. Learn so much.
I'm afraid is my group going to overpower you by being right in front?
I
was going to say, yeah. Or maybe there's nobody going to come to this group. We'll order. Yeah, that might work out best.
Well, it's okay. We'll collapse if needed. If that's not your primary interest,
I want to bring the other primary interest.
Well, if it's the two of you, then you can say, yeah,
don't worry.
I would rather you Well, we can try to recruit people over here. We'll try to get it balanced.
What is that?
This is the community university collaboration. I would like to try to poach some people from another group because this group seems to be really, really big. If there's anybody from this group, there's overlap. Yeah, we all have that here. There's a couple of you might want to come over here. Just for it'll make a little sense for get your points to the right together. Good. Yes, I'll do this one,
Social media is always the thing.
Right,
and then before we leave, make sure we get your emails. addresses, and we're going to tell you how to find us on Tuesday. But first, I want to introduce you to the song.
My name is Lisa.
Yeah.
I'm from
Boston. I'm from Maine, by the way. So,
we're in
Waterville.
Yeah. Oh, no, we're first. It's like you're stepping in.
Yeah.
I'm not from there. My grandparents are from there.
Oh,
they live up there, stepping in.
Wow.
Yeah.
And your name?
I'm Caitlin. I'm from the University.
Okay. Or people who say they're against it don't even know
why.
So when you think about community diversity collaborations and how that would apply to the occupied movement, what just brainstorm? What are some of the things that come to mind?
Especially on campus, and not just strikes, but being aware of the contracts, which I think we talked about.
And when you think about university, it's obviously all about education, and people that are in the universities now are the future and making. Right. And they're the ones that are making change now. People that are in college, they're going to be going out into the community and enacting change. So getting education for them on these diverse issues.
Yeah.
The university is perfect setting for that. And that kind of is a
great First, I have to say, I'm sorry for writing small. I got something too small.
A lot of people know it, but I don't know what you're doing.
I think that would even increase support and make it more legitimate because people would actually know what they're there for.
But do you really care about this part of the legitimacy of the occupied movement? Is that it's not based on it's co-created. It's as soon as you participate, what you're concerned about is I think that's my problem is that if you're very interested in educating that, I feel also it's not this movement is about because I just think judgment call about what movement is about.
Right.
And the truth is, it's about what people are
right.
Which has been, as we've seen, like a great, which is one of the big criticisms about so many things. The reason simple things are the
yeah.
Right, so just be careful. Like, I would just
right,
say,
no, exactly.
All about education, but not imposing.
Well, just knowing that is important. I
yeah,
think it's
yeah.
So different from other movements that hit the industry.
Yes.
You know?
Say that again, I'm sorry. So there's opportunities for
people. Okay, so we
and if I truly catch what they brought.
Through participation. And that, I think, so on time point, Mr. Durant, this is Dennis and Andrew, who's been to us in the front of the speaking on what our students think about the industry. And this is, like, the key thing that seems to be missing is the understanding that life has been yourself.
Yeah, and so we're going to
and then, so they're looking for is this environmental movement, what laws, what's going to change, et cetera. Like, this idea
yeah.
that it's whatever you're, and, you know, and obviously there's common ground there, but that's what
it's
and that, of course, is because there's participation, creating social capital. That's another huge thing in university collaboration. Any creation of social capital, any interaction, no contributor, especially if it's not a residential institution. People just put out here as students because they're computers, they work on the top of the stuff. Many sources of
Well, this in terms specifically of community university collaboration, what are some of the things? This is just brainstorming, looking at all that stuff. We might put into a letter to the executive committee that says, you know, here are some of the reasons you should write a letter to the university.
So, this is very bad.
Is there a way you want me to encapsulate that?
Solve issues, and I guess like add to that point, maybe like as well research and like funding opportunities. Like,
I think you might also be getting out
which the overlaps with
Although
not all of them, but depending, I don't know what your first point there or not.
Yeah.
You don't? Oh, you do. Yeah. It's just, the student union is a building, and it's basically all to all the different student organizations.
Right. Which are all on the high end of the
right?
So it's not
like
it's not
like a
right.
People, no, people, like, I put it for
Well, that's what you're saying. I'm going to start by an SBS student.
Yeah, it cost me 2 minutes. In that group.
Well, I don't know.
Yeah. As a random example, I am the only person here at some
Alright, so, like, that's how much I've been wrong. I know, but I just, like, that's a random sense. It's just, like, just in general, though, like, when there's because we're all commuters. Yeah, maybe.
Level, For working conditions or child labor laws allow these companies and corporations and these governments to support us. I choose that. I don't want to make your iPod for $7.50 now and then go to Mexico or somewhere else and make your iPod there, but I'm paying 31 cents an hour. He's saying no to making your iPod there. That doesn't matter. So we're not unified on our labor laws and on all that sort of stuff. Us taking a stand here in America doesn't really make a difference. And we see that as our factories where, you know, the wage jobs have been outsourced. So,
great. Perfect
topic.
Do we have more?
Utopian vision. 5 minutes. Okay. What we have is utopian vision, and one might call it hopeless idealist. But, you know, with
hopeful
ideas.
Hopeful.
Sorry about that. But, you know, for less to love nothing, we can work on making this a reality. So, first, we discuss what are the things that's keeping us from reaching this. And we first talk about how our reality of the world, of our countries, our societies, and communities are distorted. Media, we have this selfishness. Also, we talk about how American citizens and those living here are priorities, are in the wrong place. So it's geared towards ourselves and everything around us, and less towards, you know, the greater part of, you know, the world. Also, the corporations slash wealthy have a distorted view of society. We kind of share it. We kind of infiltrate our minds. You know, another aspect of reality is distorted. And ways that we can achieve a utopia is with equality in all aspects of life, gender, race, ethnicity, anything like that, religion. We need a sense of community where everyone is interdependent. I need you. Selflessness, and also we're constantly thinking about our environment and working towards keeping our environment healthy and clean. So, gas, like cars, you know, have more carpooling, buses, stuff like that. And then our responsibility, so it's long, moral. We constantly have this responsibility on our mind that teaches us to be selfless. We're constantly thinking of the bigger picture, not just how it affects us, but how it affects everyone else. And we also...
Do you wrap it up?
Yeah, I'm sorry. It's the last one. I know I could talk. But also, we need a... the last one is we need a healthy relationship between the government and the community. Like, Occupy Wall Street is trying to air its grievances with the government is not allowing that. In a utopian society, we'll be able to freely have conversations and talk the people and leaders, and it wouldn't be a problem. So that's it.
Great, great. Human behavior and context. Go.
We talked about several things. We talked about kind of the rationale for our involvement and really about how we as community psychologists have a responsibility in our field to work for first order social change on a macro level, which is what this movement is doing. And also to be, have a responsibility to be a voice for the voiceless. And at the same time, with that, it's being careful not to be a legitimizer for a group of people. How we also have a responsibility as an action-oriented field to make meaning for other academics and kind of bring academia into movement and to transfer, I've said lend and then I said it's not a library book, but to transfer community psychology expertise to help move the Occupy movement forward. And in that, we also should be focusing on making sense of their purpose and agenda, kind of bringing that forward, and also understanding how it evolved in a historical context.
Perfect. Yeah. Great stuff. I can tell you.
That's awesome. A couple of those overlap with ours, so we're popping, but we were looking at community and university collaboration, so there was some overlap. So we said that there's lots of opportunity here for students who are passionate about things. We kind of felt that students are already naturally community-oriented. So what we found sort of unanimously in our group is that our student governments tend to really get in the way. Instead of facilitating clubs, a lot of us have really restricted legislation basically in our student governments. This is microcosm, right? And that's preventing community formation. We said that the, again, opportunity to bring an understanding of the background and the goals of the movement, that would be somewhere that the university could act in the community. We said that there should be an emphasis on the opportunity to co-create the meaning of the movement. This is something we definitely use, and that seems to be a lack of understanding that you don't need to be told what the movement's about. You really don't, because by participating, you create movements about. That was something we really felt should be touched on. And we said that we're all students, especially community psychologists. What we want to do is go into the community, and so by participating with Occupy, we can learn to leverage support from the university and from other funding sources for the things that we care about in the future. And then as far as we also were told to look at what we would say to Occupy Wall Street as representatives of community psychologists or even just ourselves. We said that we really support the fight for our passions. Again, we feel that a lot of student passions really are naturally community-oriented, and this just stuff gets in the way. Everyone deserves education. Feel educating others on the purpose of Occupy Wall Street is important. That would be a way for us to support. We recognize and honor the extent that the attempts of Occupy Wall Street are to change and create unity and community. We feel that imbalance of power disrupts community. That's basically
it. Very fast. Now this is how I'm rolling back in
disrupts community, and that would be a space in which university and community could discuss.
Wonderful. As fast as possible. It's like the conscience is raising. Most people associate the Occupy movement with economic concerns, and we should increase the public consciousness about the movement's concern with social equity and environmental issues. As you can see on the declaration of the movement, there are a lot of concerns beyond the pure economic superficial level. And we should raise consciousness that reaches across and above political affiliation. We were talking about how when you talk about these issues, a lot of people who have a conservative political affiliation are reluctant to discuss it, thinking that it goes against what they stand for and how that's politicized. So ways to breach that. And we recognize that we cannot rely on the media for consciousness raising. We should increase consciousness of structural forces that contribute to oppression in individual lives, and we should create unity of individual agendas under the umbrella of consciousness raising by understanding the problems at a new goal. That's all.
Right.
Wow.
That got really good. And last but not least, ethical obligations.
Yeah. So a lot of our goals kind of overlap a little bit. We began with first, do no harm. The first rule of psychology, the first rule of human interaction, and basically the first rule of oppression. We more specifically went into social marginalization. And what do we mean by social marginalization? Not just in the workplace, not just in society, but in the social labor, sexism, multicultural awareness, inclusion of all minorities, and also the people having an equal voice, even. The luxury of having the opportunity to go on Wall Street and be able to share your voice and be part of the movement is a luxury that a lot of people did not have. And we further went into workplace integrity. the ability to combat the black youth, to be able to be promoted, and so on. We went into not only being conscious about the environment, but also social advocacy, to be advocate for oneself, for one's environment, for just to know that you have the obligation of social advocacy, and it's not just a religious problem. The other thing that we mentioned is the right to information. There's a lot of information that is hidden. There's no access to it. We are not privy to it. And it's often offensive information that is very dangerous. And lastly, we want to raise coercion awareness. How many people are being coerced? What is being coerced? And so on. And all of this will be the ninth cycle if we integrate theory and practice. And by theory, I mean empirical research, such as community-based participatory action research and other methods of research that involve the community as a co-researcher, not only as a subject. And then actually applying the empirical study to the back to the community instead of just remaining in academia.
Great. Thank you. And if people were wondering if there was a link between community psychology and Occupy Wall Street, I hope that, and what we could do, I hope that those fears can be relayed. I do want to take one quick minute to say thank you to our live streamer, back to you. We can actually access the live stream.
Yeah, when we're done, if you have a USB card, I can throw it right out for it. Yeah, it's livestream.com, Occupy Pittsburgh, videos on demand, it'll be labeled EPA conference.
Well, I'll tell you what, maybe I can get a link on the Pittsburgh Declaration page.
And
that would be great.
Do you
just have a few local
announcements? Okay, yeah. Sure, yeah, I'm Don with Occupy Pittsburgh. We lost our park on February 8th. We are actually the only Occupy that left when they asked us to after making them post a bunch of signs and ripping them down and whatnot. We got a lot of infighting and stuff going on right now. A lot of people have disappeared, gave up. Our GAs, our last two GAs, have pretty much had anywhere from 6 to 10 people. We have the anarchists in our group broke off. They don't really participate or support anymore. And we're just kind of trying to keep going. Right now, the main thing going on in Pittsburgh is Governor Corbett's cutting public transit. And in a couple of weeks or a month, the majority of Pittsburghers are going to lose their jobs because they're not going to be able to go to work. So we're focusing all of our energies into that right now. We have no plan really to set up another location at this point. We just want to get the word out on public transportation.
If we want to come to your next General Assembly, when is that and where would you go?
That's tomorrow at 4 o'clock at the United Methodist Church. I actually emailed Mary the address. If you guys want to come, everybody's welcome. And we're also doing a countywide teach-in through Occupy Pittsburgh, One Pittsburgh, SEIU, and a bunch of other organizations at the Obama Center. I'm not exactly sure where that is, but Mary has the info on that. And if you guys are still here on Sunday, our action team will be meeting at the Brugger's on Grant Street. And if you're still in town Monday, we're going to be sitting on the sheriff's sale of foreclosed homes.
I would just encourage you, if you can, go to the GA. If you've never been to one, just to see what it's like. And I mean, you can just kind of share that Occupy Pittsburgh is kind of in a tumultuous state right now, but just to get that experience, I would encourage you to go.
If you don't know what a GA is, General Assembly.
Yeah.
And to Occupy Pittsburgh, you're not alone right now. Everyone's really rough right now.
Please come to Pittsburgh Declaration on Facebook and sign up and help us. Again, we love the existence, but we would love to have it. And we actually have over 5 minutes now to sort of summarize. And if you have questions, comments, just thoughts, what you'd like to see, those things here. What would you like to see?
for those of us who didn't have enough time to discuss, who of us are going to be having dinner tonight, discuss the report about the atmosphere, it'll be the bonus.
Yeah, well, you know, actually, the community psych group, does anybody know
after
the poster session, if you are in community psych, if you're not, but just like a community psychologist, it's a good place to hide that. I guess they got the whole second floor. I was going to ask if someone had to leave. I think she was more excited. That's a wonderful place to meet, and maybe continue to fill this place.
Yes.